Thanks all, we'll commence the meeting at 6:36 PM. So thanks all, call to order. A couple things before we get to public comment, which I don't think is gonna be extensive tonight. We have a couple guests, Susan Holson from VSBA, very happy to have Dan French here, the Secretary of Education. Thank you for coming. We have noted that the roads are deteriorating, so we will try to get them in early so they can get out quickly. I think we should be able to do that. So public comment, hearing none, we'll go to consent agenda. A motion to approve the consent agenda.
I move to approve the consent agenda.
I second.
Any discussion or items we want to discuss individually? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So now learning focus. We have Hope and Emma up first. Is that okay? All right.
Okay. So we're just following the regular format. So to begin with, we just have like a list of student celebrations. So right now in the MHS cafeteria, we are celebrating our new compost sorting station. And we're doing that by hanging up lights, and it's really beautiful, and it's a happy
connection.
It is really beautiful.
I thought you just did a cleanup from the dance last week.
No, that's a celebration. It's made the cafeteria much more like efficient, and yeah, mm-hmm. It's great.
That's good. And I can talk a little bit about some student activism with ethnic studies legislation. I know that last year I actually helped, I was one of the students that helped write last year's bill, and then it ended up not passing on an omnibus bill. And this year it's slightly changed, and I testified on it this past week, and I know that Libby's going to speak a little bit on it in her superintendent's report, I believe.
It's on the superintendent's report.
And so I was able to testify with our faculty advisor from the Racial Justice Alliance, as well as the vice president of the Racial Justice Alliance, and it passed out of the Committee on Education, so I think things are going well, and we'll see what's to come. And we also have, Earth Group is organizing a Discover Half Earth assembly, and Discover Half Earth is an organization that is focused on promoting and preserving biodiversity, and they do this in a lot of different ways, and one of the ways in which they help is by is through education, and so they often organize workshops. And so Mr. Sabo, who advises Earth Group, had heard about it and was interested in organizing an assembly and having them come present to the student body, and so they'll be doing that next week, I believe.
So we're having the Pops concert next week, which is just the culmination of a lot of work for the Montpelier High School musicians, and it's just a bunch of popular music. It's a lot of fun for the audience, so yeah. And last week we hosted the first Music of Color Dance, or the RJA hosted the first Music of Color Dance, which is a celebration of Black excellence, and it was great. Mercedes Mack is a wonderful DJ.
Emma and I both went. It was a good time. There weren't many students there, but it still was a really positive environment, and we had a good time, and so we're excited to see this be a tradition and see it how it grows in years to come.
So right now Student Council is working on a new scholarship. It's very new, but I think that effort is something we should encourage. And so, yeah, we just decided to include that in this celebration.
Yeah, it's aimed to use our funds to support student leadership and, academic excellence. And Last but not least, a member of Earth Group and a sophomore named Maple Perchlick spoke today at a press conference led by 350 Vermont, and it involves the prevention of new fossil fuel infrastructure and two policies and legislation that have been proposed this session that are in regards to that, and so she spoke in support of it, and she did a phenomenal job from what I've heard, so we're proud of her. And we also, it's Black History Month, in case you don't know, and the Racial Justice Alliance is doing so much this month, and we've already had a presentation to sort of introduce the month and explain what we did last year and celebrate that and raising the flag and talk about what we plan on doing over the next few weeks. And so we have movie nights planned and optional TED Talks that students can go to during Sullenblock, and there are videos that relate to race and microaggressions, and so we're hoping to, and also a movie called I Am From Here, and it's a film that specifically focuses on racism in Vermont and the nuances that of it, and I think it's good because sometimes students don't understand how race and racism can really impact their own lives. And obviously the Music of Color Dance was a fun part of what we have planned this month. And this week on Friday, I know that I'm one of the people working on the questions, we have an activity known as Unpacking Your Invisible Knapsack. And that is like a privilege walk in that it asks certain questions of students, and they have the option to opt out, but the way a privilege walk works is that everyone starts in a line and then they'll step forward if they have certain advantages based on race, socioeconomic status, and so for the students who do want to participate and for those who are watching, it's a good opportunity to reflect on their own privileges and biases. And we did it last year and it went pretty well, so we're excited to do it again.
Okay, so just moving quickly on to the student concerns and needs. It's the same as it has been for a while, which is just the need to support diversity and inclusion in all of our schools. And so we kind of have some questions that go along with this section. So first one is like equity policy updates. I guess we have some more questions, but I don't know if you want to be more specific.
Yeah, I mean, we were just curious because we weren't present during the first reading of the policy and how it went, and we noticed the edits in the Google Doc, and we're excited to see those and appreciated that. And we're also just curious in general about ways in which we can help you all in being the voice of students in the MRPS district, and if there's like a suggestions box or some sort of way in which we can interact with students and get their opinions on certain topics and let them know that what they're telling us will go to the school board. So if there's anything we can do.
And just going off of that, this is something that I wrote in the later section, but I'm hoping to send a survey out to the middle school and try and get in touch with students at the elementary school as soon as possible, because I recognize that our celebrations are very Montpelier High School centric.
That's true.
And I know that the Racial Justice Alliance, in a few months, once we get through Black History Month and all the fun planning that and festivities that accompany that, are planning on working on an equity audit of some sort and a survey, and working with a company perhaps to draft up a survey to go out to middle school and high school students to sort of gauge the environment as it relates to equity. And
so student perspective.
So Club Action has recently been trying to focus on tackling socioeconomic status and class and classism as it relates to MHS students. And it's a relatively new venture in high schools and for us as well. And so before we really jump in, we're trying to coordinate with perhaps someone who works for a nonprofit organization and is experienced in dealing with issues of equity and inclusion to learn how we can best start a conversation about class and socioeconomic status and poverty as it relates to students in the district and in supporting all of our students and seeing how it relates to the achievement gap, for example. And so I know we met with Mr. McGrath about a week ago, and so we're gonna start working on that.
Just to add on to that quickly, the reason that that was like inspired was because of the students in that club recognized that there was a lack of like discussion about mm-hmm. socioeconomic like tension in our school. Mm-hmm. So
which doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. It just means that we aren't talking about
it. Yeah, we aren't talking about it. And so that's an important student perspective to have, I think. So.
And we also have a restorative practices student-led group that's operating at MHS. And Emma and I joined it pretty recently because there were actually several groups that had popped up at around the same time. And so some of them will be attending a training at the Unitarian Church tomorrow about how to implement restorative practices and restorative circles at MHS. And I know that our guidance counselors are involved in it, and I'm excited to see what it'll look like in future months. And Emma and I, as well as Marianne Songhurst, who's vice president of the RJA, are going to a national education conference next week in Jackson, Mississippi, and we're very excited about that. And it relates to race and civil rights and school closings in Jackson, Mississippi, and so we're excited to sort of share out from that once we get back. And Earth Group is currently interested in working with the cafeteria to reduce food waste and trash, and possibly do that by changing the plates we use. And so we're going to work with cafeteria and the student body to see how that would best work. All right, That's it.
Yeah,
go change the world, ladies.
Yeah.
Go change the world.
That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Very much. That
you,
was wonderful.
You might check in. You had commented about checking in the elementary school and the middle school and the equivalent of their student council. So, like, the organization in the middle school and whatever happens in the elementary school, you might talk to
right.
the kids.
That's a good idea.
Maybe the Crafter's Edge.
Yeah, I don't think they have that in the middle school. But you could also ask the principals, I don't know, it's redundant. We all, you know, Solon salutes. So the middle school has one and the elementary school has one. And everyone on the board gets all three. So we see student news in that way.
No,
we don't.
There's a Roxbury
one.
We should be getting
it. So we should get it.
Okay.
Get it.
Good to know.
I'll make a note on that one.
Thank you.
Yep.
For the Black History Month activities that you're talking about, are there some of those for the community as well? Or are they all for students?
I think it's primarily, it's just for students in this, in the school community.
And is it open to all students?
I think we're working on involving middle school students, but for the most part, like the workshops and the TED Talks are for high school students.
And not just for specific classes of students, right?
No, it's for the
whole school.
Yeah, it's open to the whole school.
And how do you go about letting other students know about those events?
Usually through announcements, and in the Solon Salutes, there's a calendar too with activities that has been emailed out, and at our first assembly that we had, I think about a week ago, explaining, we outlined our activities for the rest of the month.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Yeah.
The guys did great.
Excellent, as always. Before I move on, there are two little points of business I forgot. We're going to have brief discussions of snow days, because we want to give us a quick update, because we there's some board action that might be taken, need to be taken to make sure that we don't put our kiddos in school the last week of June, which will not be popular. Repossession of, sadly, Mark McCrith is leaving us, and we will be doing a principal search, so repossession of that. There'll be board representative.
Provost Principals Association?
Yeah. Great, so next up we have Susan Holson from Vermont School Boards Association, who's kind enough to come and tell us about what the SBA does for us. And she was, I know you were planning on observing the whole meeting, but given the roads.
Yeah.
And if you could take a seat at the table, please, so the home audience can hear you as well.
Do you have a big home audience?
Huh? So we have a larger home audience than one would think. Yes.
Okay. So as Jim said, I work for the Vermont School Boards Association, which I hope you're all familiar with. And my purpose in wanting to come to your meeting today was twofold. One was to share with you what the SBA does and how we can support you. And the other is you're the second stop on a statewide tour that will be extending over the next 6 months. I'm visiting a lot of school boards, mostly to make sure that the services and the supports that we make available to our members are relevant for you and that we know what you're talking about. You know, it's squeaky wheels and all of that. And wow, wow, I can't say enough for what I just heard from your students. I think it's amazing. You guys are awesome. So the Vermont School Boards Association, which, in case you don't know, is like two blocks from here. We have a dual mission, but it all, of course, is about educating our children, primarily in public schools, but the K-8 population. And that mission is, part of that mission is public policy and advocacy work on behalf of Vermont's children. And I have a colleague who spends her days, I haven't seen her in 2 weeks, she's at the State House pretty much every day, all day at committee meetings, and today is in two places at once, I think, as there were bills on the floor that needed attention, as well as things going on in Senate Ed that required her attention. And she's the director of Legal and Policy Services, and her name is Sue Siglowski, and she puts out a weekly bulletin for board members. I hope you're all getting it.
Yep.
A legislative update that I think comes out Fridays, typically, to give you an update on what's going on in the State House and if any action from board members around the state makes sense, we'll try and prod you into that. And the other piece of our mission is to support school boards in the hard work that you do and give you the resources that you might not know where to find otherwise. I am personally responsible for board development, so training of new board members, digging a little deeper beyond the routine consent agenda items, and I am available to come meet with your board at, I'd say, any time, except I just double booked myself today, so I have to be a little bit careful about that. But we're here, and we're a phone call away. We're also a walk, but you know, phone call, email, texting us, it's all good. And if you have a quick question about open meeting law or whether it's the board's job to X, Y, or Z, we're a great resource. So please, you're paying us dues every month. Every year, so get your money's worth. And as I said, my intent was to be here for your whole meeting tonight, but given the fact that I have an hour's drive and what I'm hearing about the roads, I'm going to beg off now, and I will come back and just observe a meeting at a later date. Does anyone have any
questions
for me? Yeah.
Does the School Board Association employ anybody who does specialize?
We do not have an analyst. We do have a contract database
right,
that
I'm
is available.
Familiar with that.
Okay.
I feel like a service that would be helpful, and I know it can be a little bit tricky because there's a lot of discrepancies between the contracts. but there's also a lot of commonalities, and there's ways of getting to those commonalities, and it would be a really powerful resource for school boards to have, I think, some better analytics. It's just an idea that the association might
Thank you. I will pass that along. That's a great idea.
I think as we've waded into the negotiation process this year and are thinking about it moving forward, having that type of resource would be really powerful, and I know it would be powerful for a bunch of other school boards as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I'm just floating it tonight.
So that you have data beyond your
so we
area.
Can contextualize the metrics that we're partnering on, and we can make sure that not only our taxpayers but also our teachers, everybody's coming to a common understanding of where we are within the context of the state.
Right.
And there are ways that we can do that through the great database that you guys have put together, but that seems like a service that a lot of school boards could benefit from. So
I will pass that along. We have a 23-member board, which is comprised of 11 regions around the state, each with two representatives and a president. And when it comes to things like our staffing issues and the associated expenditures, that all obviously goes through them, but it's a great suggestion, and I will certainly pass it along.
Or even if it wasn't at your employee, if it was a contracted service, like
mm-hmm.
I'm just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Got it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Tina?
I'm curious to know, maybe I should know this, but I'm curious to know if within the organizations there's a list of the data that's available. What do you collect, and might we see it? In other words, I don't even know what you do
that? It's available on our website.
Yeah.
There's login protection, so if you don't have the log, there's, I believe it's one login per district, so you should be able to access that.
It's a repository of contracts, so we can go through all the different districts and supervisory union contracts.
That I knew about, but I was curious, do they keep any other data? And I didn't know.
My understanding is not much.
They have a lot of tools.
Right.
You know,
so
very helpful.
I was just thinking
yeah.
between the organizations, it seems like you're the perfect place to have collective.
That's what I was kind of, that's what I was suggesting,
right.
yeah.
yeah.
Well, in terms of things like collective bargaining, yes. A lot of the metrics and data that support education and provide direction on where we need to be going is really in the bailiwick of the agency.
Which, when with this common chart field of accounts, will make these types of data analyses and comparisons much easier
mm-hmm.
moving forward, which I understand that's
right.
that's a big struggle as well.
Mm-hmm.
Compared
yeah,
to this
there's no standardization
because,
of pretty much anything.
Yes.
yes.
Anybody else?
Thank you.
So call me.
Yes. yes. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you very
appreciate
much.
Appreciate it.
Have a safe drive back.
Sorry.
Oh, no worries. I very much understand. It's supposed to get nasty. I think it's starting to get nasty. So have a safe drive.
Thank you.
So next up, Secretary French. Again, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Good evening. Secretary Dan French. I've been on the job since August. I'm not a stranger to Vermont. I started my career as a teacher and as a principal and then a superintendent for 12 years. Also worked at higher ed. My last job worked at St. Michael's College, running the graduate program for school leaders, and also did a lot of consulting around the state on a variety of issues, largely working with school boards, interestingly enough. So I'm very familiar with your work, and thank you for it. It's hard work. But other than that, I just thought I'd stop in and introduce myself, and if you have specific questions, I'd be happy to have a conversation with you about any issues you'd like.
Well, thank you for the offer. I will open it up to the board.
If there's none, that's fine.
I have one, Jim.
Go for it.
I know at one point, you had proposed or suggested a statewide school district. Is that dead, or is that idea still alive?
Yeah, I spent the better part of a morning talking about that idea. It's the the single district is sort of an outcome of a logic model, and so the logic is more important to me than the single district. I think the overarching logic was the system itself is too complex, and that we need to work at simplifying it. And actually, the complexity is interfering with our ability to ensure quality and equity across the state. And my hypothesis would be that the complexity is also the chief cause of our relative inefficiency. I called design elements of things I would suggest would be key ingredients of the education system, then worked them out to the most extreme example of simplification, which was the one school district model. So what I'm doing now with that is asking, inviting people to contribute to that document. It's going to be turned into a website here shortly as a WordPress blog. I was meeting with a group of higher ed folks this morning to see if they would be interested in discussing the implications of simplification of the K-12 system on higher education. So it's the process itself is not dead, but it's more of a visioning process than anything else.
So I actually have a question. My understanding is that with some pretty major ACTS initiatives like Act 173, which changes the way special ed is funded,
right.
E-finance, which I know is a big concern of our business manager, AOE right now has some vacancies, and there's some kind of capacity issues in terms of being able to get that work done and get districts the help they need. What's the plan to address those?
Yeah, so you bring up several issues. One is, we have major policy initiatives at play right now in the state and education. I honestly can't think of a time when we've had so many significant issues, significant policy initiatives happening at the same time. You mentioned 173, which I think will quickly become probably the focus of all your work and all of our work statewide. It's a major reform of the special ed finance system, but also coupled with that are changes in how we deliver special ed services, and the two kind of go hand in hand. So it's a major piece of work. We have 166, which is early education, and that's not done by any means. I mean, we're working down a path, rightfully so, of putting some solid investments in that end of our delivery system. I'd say we're still not done with refining that.
Yep.
We have Act 77, our personalized learning law, which is has a toehold, but folks are still working through several issues around that. Act 46, so while all these other things are going on, we're also reconfiguring a lot of our school districts. And then we have major data systems that are being implemented. My tenure in Vermont, I can't think of a time when we've ever delivered a single statewide data system, yet we're trying to do five basically now at the same time. And there are capacity issues at the agency in terms of delivering on those issues. It's been a challenge for me as a new secretary to sort of begin to understand that. I was sort of surprised because I had heard that over the years that we didn't have adequate capacity at the agency. But when I arrived, we had approximately 25 vacancies and only six were under active recruitment. So part of what I've been doing is really heating up our recruitment process and at the same time trying to get a handle on what things that we really need to add some capacity to. A lot of our positions in the agency are funded through grant programs, but a lot of the positions that are related to the data systems and so forth are not, and those are ones that would come from the general fund expenditure at the state level. So we do have to beef up capacity in that area, but I'm also interested in making sure that some of the systems we choose are not overly complex for us to deliver on. I think sometimes we shoot ourselves in our own foot by choosing certain approaches. In the case of the business system, it's a very complex idea. We had an initiative to create what's called a uniform chart of accounts, meaning that's not related to the information system. That was just to get every school district using the same basically checkbook and accounting system structure. And then sort of recently, the legislature decided to include with that an initiative to go to a statewide accounting system. So we're trying to do both at the same time, very challenging. And then throw Act 46 into that where, we have new central offices coming online, very complex. So we're in the process, heard a lot of feedback from business managers. We did a sort of, I would call it almost a pilot implementation this fall with three districts in the state, and we didn't learn much from that. The three districts were relatively inexperienced and hadn't had a lot of experience with changing systems and so forth. So we had to sort of refine our response based on their abilities. But now we're faced with, I think, rolling out the system of 42 school districts simultaneously. So we're about to go to the legislature to ask for a delay on some key elements of this. We're not backing away from our commitment to do it, and I don't think business managers are either. I think it's an important achievement if we can do it. But it's important to acknowledge that there's a lot of complexity to it, and we haven't had a lot of history as a state of doing things like this centrally. And I think Act 46 in particular has exacerbated some of the challenges that folks are facing. It was the back offices, the business offices are changing in many cases.
Can I ask a follow-up question to that, just while we're on that topic? So the Uniform Chart of Accounts is one issue. The other is the accounting system. Are they both on the same timeline right now?
Essentially, districts currently, I believe it was 2020. Grant, would you know the exact date?
Yeah, I mean, July 1 was supposed to be for both.
Yeah. So the idea was that the chart of accounts mandate came out first, and then the system was promoted as a way one could achieve alignment with the chart of accounts. By definition, the new system would be based on the new chart of accounts, and it was sort of a carrot and stick approach. We had some incentives for people to jump on early with that, but it was really challenging for folks to figure out when to jump in and. We have to go back and rethink how we're going to support districts with doing it. We had a different model of implementation. Now we're faced with, as I mentioned, with 42 some odd districts. So it's one of the things we're going to be looking at is trying to push back the deadline a little bit to give us a little more time.
Do you think you might set up an implementation team of sorts to help assist with this?
Yeah, one of the things I did write off was ask the Business Managers Association for sort of a design team to help us with that feedback loop, because we didn't really have that component in place. We're also asking for additional resources at the agency. I think we have the position identified. We're trying to fill that right now. So it's both a question of us building up capacity. It's a question of building up feedback capacity from the field to have that come into us in a focused way as opposed to coming from each business manager. And then we've also worked with a vendor to rethink how they're going to support this rollout. So it's been a multi-pronged approach. But it's an important initiative. So, the good news is there's broad agreement that it should be done. It's just a question of how to do it. And I had to go back and revisit the purchasing decision of the specific system to make sure the system itself had the functionality I needed. I was hearing that perhaps it didn't, but I pretty quickly learned it does. So it's a complex issue.
Do you have a timeline in mind that you're willing to share for what you think? Ideally for AOE, what that would look
well,
like?
Well, I think we're going to be asking for an additional year. We're working on it this starting on Monday with the legislature. So hopefully that will be supported.
Thank you.
Yep.
Tina.
I just have to tell you, I'm worried.
Oh, yes, Tina?
Here, you just listed all those initiatives. You
right.
told us you don't have the staff to do it.
I didn't quite say that. I said I had some vacancies.
Oh, okay, well.
I will leave employment applications. I understand you have some experience at the agency.
I don't need another job.
Okay.
But you need some more people. And what I'm feeling like as a board member is,
right.
and yet we have the timeline, and you're expecting us to truck on. And I'm not seeing how you could offer support. So can you give me some encouragement?
Yeah, I think, you just heard me say we are going to beef up our capacity, but we're also asking for the timelines to be adjusted on this specific project. But I think it's hopefully something I'll be able to do in the legislative process is bring sort of that lens of practicality. You know, as someone who, like you, has been on the receiving ends of implementing things over the years, I know, as a superintendent, as a principal, how to build budgets, how to do information system implementation. So I'm hopeful that I can make an impact on our policy design so that we factor implementation into some of these initiatives. What is the assessment of capacity before we begin to lay in another layer of requirements on the system? It's been a challenge, I think, in the state. I was talking this morning with a higher ed group. We really have an excellent education system in the state. I don't think that's necessarily because of our policy. I think it's almost in spite of it. We've had some really good initiatives, particularly in Act 77. I think the personalized learning is really important. But that was done with little thought to implementation and support. And so the field has figured out how to do these things on their own. That's not right. So we have to figure that out as a state, and I'm committed to helping inform the legislative process. But I did not establish these deadlines. You know, these deadlines came out from the law. I did not think it was a good idea necessarily to try to implement five major information systems simultaneously when we've never done one. You know, so it's we're all struggling with this. But I think if we all work together and focus on, particularly, I think I was impressed with the business system, you know, that in spite of the difficulties, and there were a lot the business managers were really struggling with, I still think, you know, grant a comment, I think there's still broad commitment to going to a single system if we can get there, because it adds a lot of value to our ability to provide you better data and understand, you know, inform the deliberations on policy.
I'm not suggesting that these initiatives aren't
sure.
good. I'm just, for example, concerned about my business manager.
Yeah, and I am too, and it's, I think, I guess we're agreeing on our diagnosis of the situation, right? But I'm committed to adding resources, and I'm committed to you know, extending the timelines on certain initiatives and sort of bringing some of these initiatives into coherence on an implementation time frame.
Good, we'll be watching you.
Thank you. It's exciting work.
Thank you for coming, and this is also a follow-up to Jim's question. In a similar vein, I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit more about how you see the agency's role in leading and supporting the implementation of Act 173.
Yeah, we have a significant role. You're all familiar with 173, more or less. It's I've heard people refer to it as landmark legislation. You know, and it's, I think it's significant. It should not be underestimated. I'd put it on equal scale to Act 46. So there's basically two components. 173 is about modifying our special education systems. Two components. One is revising the financial part of it, and that's predicated on the second part, which is a change in the delivery model. I'd encourage you to go read it. There's two major studies that informed those two branches of the law. UVM did a study on the financial model, and then an outside group, the DMG, or District Management Council, did a piece on the delivery model of the professional program side of it.
Can I interrupt you for one second?
Yeah.
Have you all seen the DMG in particular? Have you seen, I just want to make sure, because it came out before my time with the board, so I just want to check
on that. Yeah, it would be worthy of your board to spend some focused time reading and becoming acquainted. I think it's accessible, too. It's not like a lot of reading, but it's really important. And you're going to be living this for the next several years.
Yeah.
So the financial piece is really going to be articulated through a rulemaking process through the State Board of Education. And the Agency of Education is the entity that does that work, essentially. 173 created an advisory group of practitioners and stakeholders that give input into that process, including the rulemaking process. But it's really the agency's role to provide the technical and legal support to help the State Board work through a rulemaking process. So that will be starting probably the late March timeframe. So I encourage you to follow along. So the agency has a direct role there. The agency also has a direct role with identifying, facilitating the supports that'll go on the professional side of the 173 in terms of what supports will districts need on a professional development basis to implement what we call multi-tiered support systems on a more systematic way. So we have a role in providing that support as well, though we do that largely through supervising a contract or convening resources for vendors who will provide those services.
So those contractors and vendors will be available to the districts?
Yes, yeah. But we're, that part of it is still, you know, we're really in a sort of a feedback loop with different stakeholders about how to refine the professional development approach. A lot of the energy right now has just been on launching the rulemaking process. And the mechanics of the financial system, if you're not familiar with that, are significant in that currently you receive reimbursement for special education expenditures. Approximately 56% of your costs are reimbursed by the state. We're moving to a block grant system, which puts you in sort of a box, if you will, on your costs, but it's once again predicated on the practice changing in a certain way. The good news with a block grant, you also get greater flexibility in how to utilize those funds, so you can make investments in non-special ed activities that might theoretically lower your special ed costs.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Michelle?
Yep. I'm still back on Act 77.
Okay.
And I'm glad to hear you acknowledge that there wasn't a lot of support for creating a statewide implementation of that. And I think that
Montpelier has worked really, really hard to do a good job in the transition to proficiency. And I know that we've had other schools come visit us to see how it's working. But I know that we still have a long way to go to get to the vision of a real proficiency-based assessment system. And we're doing more and more personalization, but again, kind of feeling our way through it.
Right.
At the same time, I've heard, you know, I know Vermont's really small, right? So I know parents at high schools in other towns all over Vermont. And when I run into them, they tell me, they ask, how are you dealing with this proficiency thing in Montpelier? Because we hate it at our school. You know, I hear a lot of negative response from parents, and I'm a little worried that the uneven implementation across the state is going to result in a pullback on that. And is the agency, like, I know you have all this other stuff in front of you.
Right.
Are you able to go back to Act 77 and provide any support?
Yeah, I think so. I think, you know, largely, you know, I'm a non-voting member of the State Board of Education, as Secretary of Education. And the State Board has been very involved with Act 46. You might be aware of that. They're anxious for their responsibilities to be ended in that regard. And one of the first things they brought up is, and particularly the chair of the State Board, Krista Hooling, is a teacher in South Burlington at a high school. They're very interested in revisiting the education quality standards, you know, which is one of the things that Act 77 brought to the table was a move away from school quality standards to education quality standards, like focusing more on output as opposed to input. And I agree with that assessment. It's worthy of us, it's a good time for us to go back and just reinvigorate the entire conversation, not necessarily to repeal it or modify it, but just to elevate its importance, because I think that's the beginning of understanding a lot of these concepts. And I was listening today with a colleague from the Tarrant Foundation. I don't know if you've done work with them. And they're starting to be in a position now. They do a lot of work on technology and personalization, largely at the middle level, but really statewide now. And they're doing some research around Act 77 implementation. And, you know, they were really framing out, I thought it was a useful paradigm that it's, you know, the overarching concept is personalizing student learning, which I think is what everyone in the world is faced with, largely through technology, and it's a wonderful thing, really, to try to put student aspirations at the center of our design. Vermont's policy, however, is based on three approaches, and one of them is proficiencies, but the other two are equally important, you know, in personalized learning plans, and the other is flexible pathways. Mm-hmm. So I think what I'd like to do with the State Board's leadership is to elevate the conversation back to quality and put some emphasis on all three elements needing to be in place for districts. We also have other resources we can reinvigorate. We started with Act 77 was originally passed. We had some resources coming from the Great Schools Partnership in Maine, and you know, we basically gave them some grant funds to do that. I think there are places in the state that have found a way to do this. There's other places that are really struggling, but I think we need to certainly get the State Board to elevate the conversation and then really promote a coherent model based on what has already emerged as really positive approaches in many of our Vermont districts, and then figure out how to scale that. Mm-hmm. But I think the issue around scaling is not about proficiency-based grading, which is unfortunately where a lot of people got hung up.
Yes.
And rightfully so, because there wasn't a lot of guidance on it. But really
everyone seems to have done it differently.
That's right. Or, and to my, painful for me to watch as a consultant, is they do the same thing but in isolation and spend all that time not sharing with each other, you know. So I'd go from district to district and, oh, you're doing this, did you talk to your neighbor? They've already, you know, no, we got to do it ourselves, you know. We do that a lot in Vermont, and that's unfortunate. But I think to promote a model where we really need to figure out how to leverage the PLP better, I think it's a really critical pedagogical tool. And the law requires that 7 through 12. In my former district, we had high school choice 9 through 12. We leveraged that at K through 8. So I think there's room to extend the PLP down much earlier with students. And then to build out the flexible pathways in simultaneously when we're talking about proficiency. So I think it's really about bringing all three of those things into focus and balance. And the good news is we've had some districts in the state be able to do that very successfully. It's a question really of scaling it. And I think, you know, giving people the tools they need to do the communications planning as well around it.
And so you're saying you see that as work for the state board?
The state board is definitely moving it. We've already started a process where we're going to have two vacancies on the state board, so we slowed down a little bit. But at our last meeting, they had a general orientation to the regulations. At the next meeting, they're going to talk about the how we measure that or plan to measure that under the Every Student Succeeds Act. So for them, it's sort of like foundational orientation, and then they're going to embark on some sort of conversation. I know they're interested in highlighting the work and going around the state and listening to hear, you know, what are the best practices and what they could do. So I think, you know, I'm going to try to use that as a lever to advance the work and highlight best practice and what has emerged when we've had really successful examples in the state to see what we can do to scale that work better.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Becky?
So what do you see on the horizon for Act 166?
Yeah, that's been a, you know, it's one of the more challenging policy areas. When I arrived, you know, the governor has a vision of cradle to career education, and it's very common sort of, I think, articulation of the importance of education today in our society, in our world, that it's related to economic development as much as social and human development. When I was starting to work through the policy challenges and sort of do an inventory of where I thought my leadership would be tasked the most, I quickly determined that early education was probably going to be the most challenging policy area. In spite of everything I've talked about tonight, I think that's still true. Largely because there is, firstly, in a sort of a ironic situation, there is broad policy agreement that early education is probably the most important investment we can make. We have strong research that points to that. We had broad consensus across the political spectrum that early education is vital. In spite of that, we have broad disagreement about how to best do it. And I think 166 is better than Act 62. I also, you know, as a new secretary, getting up to speed on several initiatives, was coincidentally reading 173, the special ed reform bill, or law, simultaneously when I was reading 166. I was like, literally had them on the desk. And they stand in stark contrast to each other. 173 is a comprehensive approach, very well thought out. It's got supports, it's got research behind it. 166 is not well written. It's imperfect in many ways, has a whole aspect of dual agency oversight. I have a series of administrative complaints coming from school districts and from daycare centers that I can't really administer very well because the agencies themselves don't agree on how to administer. So I was talking to a daycare center the other day, and I started my career in Canaan, Vermont, in the Northeast Kingdom, and I was talking to a private provider in that region. I said, like, how's it going? And she said, you know, her quote was something like, the regulations were so overwhelming, I almost closed my business, you know? We can't afford that to happen in rural areas, let alone in populated areas where people are finding challenges to have access to care. So I think there's a lot of room for improvement on 166. Yes, we have to make significant investments in that area. I'm as the governor is supportive of further investments in early education, I'm very concerned about the current delivery model, though, and I'm not interested in making investments until we can really get some clarity on the delivery model. There was a bill introduced, Senate Bill 10, in the Senate Edge Committee that I think started a really good conversation on how to improve the delivery model. One element it did was simplify the definition of quality, which I think is really important. What we had previously, there was a multiple sort of layers to defining quality. One is a private provider could be NAICS accredited, a National Association accreditation, or it could have 4 stars in the Vermont quality system, or it could have 3 stars if it did these, had a plan, you know. It basically eliminated that sort of last description and just said, let's have NAICS accreditation or a certain number of stars. And I think that is a good, concise definition. It allows us to go forward in quality monitoring in a much more proactive and transparent way, which I think would be beneficial to everyone. But the dual agency oversight is really challenging. And that's, I feel compelled on behalf of the field. I've heard a lot of, from school board members, from the superintendents and principals, that 166 does not work. And as I mentioned, I have administrative complaints that I'm anxious to resolve, but I can't because they're disagreements. So what Senate Bill 10 proposes is to basically the education piece would fall to the Agency of Education and the care piece would fall to the Agency of Human Services, not have the dual agency oversight. And I think, honestly, I think that's necessary at this point.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Any other questions? Steve?
Just wondering where we're at on the status of the few towns that want extensions on the on Act 46 to not have to meet the July 1 deadline. You know, we as a district, we didn't have to wait till our back was up against the wall. We didn't have to wait till we had a huge financial pressure. We were, you know, we're a fairly stable district. We have fairly stable tax rates, fairly stable populations, and we were proactive in that, and we did it because it was the law and because we knew what the intent was of the legislation, and we didn't want to be you know, we wanted to basically be good citizens. We worked with Roxbury and came up with a very creative solution that we think helps both towns in the end, and we're wondering whether, you know, your opinion would be that we need to be offering extensions at this point, or whether we can just ask folks to comply with the law that's been, the handwriting's been on the wall a long time.
Yeah, it's a tough one. And as you know, we're being sued on it, so I'm going to limit my comments to a certain extent as a named litigant in that process. But I believe, well, as of today, there was no decision reached. I believe that was the end, how they ended the day today on how to approach this issue. I'm sort of two minds. I agree with you that, you know, and that's the districts I supported read the law and determined, you know, part of the energy or tension that allowed them to come to agreement was the threat of having the state force us to do it otherwise. So they figured out how to respond to that. On the other hand, I'm very familiar with the work that is required when you merge districts, let alone when you merge it through a forced process. So I'm not quite sure why the legislature thought that 4 months would be sufficient to do that work. So I'm sympathetic to, just in a narrow way, looking at those districts that might need more time that are legitimately interested in complying with the law or as the state board has forced them to merge. So I think, you know, that I would say is essentially the dilemma that the legislature is struggling with now, how to provide that additional support without necessarily backing away from what was a broad, you know, broad commitment, I say politically broad commitment to move the state towards fewer school districts. So I don't know where they're going to end up with it, but I am sympathetic to the districts that need more time. I'm worried about opening the larger can of worms, so to speak, on Act 46.
I mean, I think your first statement, when I asked you your first question, your commitment to the thought exercise of simplification, consolidation and simplification, and therefore raising efficiency levels, seems to be consistent with Act 46's intentions, and if we unwind it, we're sort of going in the other direction.
Yes. You know, I think, you know, my other point would be this is before the courts, and I think, you know, there's fundamental constitutional issues that have been called into play, and those we should wait for the courts to give us some direction on that before we proceed much further. I think that's an important consideration. My understanding is that we're going to receive some guidance from the court fairly quickly this month, at least one of the lawsuits. So I'm hopeful that'll help give us some understanding of what the context is from a legal standpoint.
Any other questions, Secretary? Bridget?
You were talking earlier about outputs and the quality standards, and one quality issue that, you know, I always think of this time of year, we're approaching the SBAC season in schools in a few weeks after winter break, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your views about the SBAC, whether you think it's a good metric, whether you know, what do you think it's showing us about the statewide system, and if you have any thoughts on other metrics the state should be using.
Yeah, I think it's a great question. I, you know, back to the point on quality, I think, and I think there's agreement on this, that we're at a very interesting point of time, you know, as a state. We've come out from the No Child Left Behind Act. You know, we were one of the few states that never received a waiver from that. And, you know, in 2014, essentially labeled all our schools as failing schools. And ESSA, the new version of you know, the Elementary Secondary Education Act doesn't, you know, it's basically, I think it's oriented to providing states more flexibility. So we feel like we have more flexibility, and we've created an accountability system that certainly, I think, meets our needs a little better. We've yet to sort of really bring that online, but I think it's positioned and it's described in a much more thoughtful way than what was this, if you remember, adequate yearly progress at all. So, mm-hmm. And I should back up, you know, that's, people get, I think, confused sometimes. Standards, assessments, and accountability systems, they're three different things. So we have the Common Core, which Vermont has adopted. Our State Board of Education adopts standards. And then we have an assessment, in this case SBAC, which, you know, essentially at the federal level we were required to do one or the other. Some states were able to build their own, and now we've seen some backtracking of that. We grouped with a group of districts that designed an assessment called SBAC, which is designed to measure student achievement of the Common Core standards. And then states are required to have accountability systems, you know, which both No Child Left Behind Act had this thing called adequate yearly progress. We're not doing that anymore. We have an accountability system that's based on education quality reviews, includes some integrated field reviews, and then a snapshot of data, including SBAC data. So I think, you know, SBAC has turned out to be a pretty good project. We've had some concern recently. You know, I'm a member of the Chief Council of State School Officers, or the Council of Chief State School Officers, the CCSSO. There's a group of us that are members of the SBAC consortium. There's politically doesn't seem to be a lot of will among some of the members to conduct a reliability and validity study of SBAC. So we're really concerned. Some of us that are interested in valid and reliable data are concerned about that. My understanding is that's been pushed back to like 2025. So, you know, we'll continue to use it for the moment, but we'll increasingly have some concerns about its validity. I think, you know, my bias would to start be thinking more systemically about what is our portfolio of assessments that we can use across the entire state for all schools. I think there's some things we could be doing around personalized learning plans in terms of assessment of some more qualitative measures. You know, are we truly building a system around student aspirations or not? Part of our accountability system also includes a school climate survey component, so we're hoping to bring that online this summer. That's another important indicator for me. And I think there's room for us to have a good benchmark assessment at the primary grades. Every school, I'm not sure what you use, but I'm sure you have a benchmark assessment of some sort. And these are, when I say benchmark, they're usually given three times a year to give us an indication of how students are making progress on math and reading in particular. And there's a series of several commercial products that are being used by different districts across the state. I think we'd, if there's room and people are interested, I'd be interested in the idea of exploring having a single benchmark assessment done statewide, because I think the more we can do to put common tools in the hands of teachers, you know, I think the more we can do to share best practices better. It's hard when we bring teachers across district boundaries together, some sort of professional development event, if they're measuring quality using different tools, you know. And I think the formative benchmark assessments are so well ingrained. Most districts have them already. I think there's a place there we might want to explore to have a single system. I think it would save us some money, but also, once again, on this idea of sharing practices across district boundaries, I think it would be helpful to have a single tool set. So I feel pretty good about where we're at in terms of our quality reviews. We still haven't brought it online fully yet, but I think the SBAC has proven to be a pretty good tool. We have some preliminary correlation data that suggests it's a pretty good predictor of what it's designed to measure, but I am concerned about the broader validation studies that are now being put off due to political concerns.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Those studies that you're talking about, are those at the federal level?
Yeah, it's really, yes, at a national level. It's really the group, there's a consortium of states that are behind the SBAC, mm-hmm. and it's getting that consortium agree to okay. Fund and support those studies.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
I don't know if you didn't say, but you might be like Susan on a truck around from board to board, but we appreciate you coming. Like,
Yeah, and I was going to end tonight by saying I'd welcome to come back. I do enjoy board meetings. I used to report the 56 board members as my superintendent of a large multi-district supervising. But you're geographically convenient for me. So if there, you know, we could schedule it a couple times a year predictably, I'd welcome the opportunity to come back. It sharpens my focus to hear from you. And I perhaps can share, you know, give you some insight into what we're doing as well. So I encourage you to take advantage of our geographic proximity.
Yeah, no, we appreciate it. And we will like you take you up on that.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Nice to meet
you all.
Very helpful.
Have a good meeting.
Okay. Hoping Emma drives safe.
Yes.
Thanks.
So, yeah, very far to go. So entry plan conversation.
Do you want to do snow day?
I was going to see if you wanted to do snow day. So let's do snow day in principle, and then we'll do entry plan. I think snow day should take not very long.
No, it shouldn't take long. The snow day, so we're at 4 snow days. When the calendar was created last year, we have 178 student days between teacher-student contact and our contract. And the state's quota is 175 days. Those numbers are just important. So in our calendar, we scheduled for 178 plus 3. That got us to the Friday, June
21st.
Thank you. June 21st. You looked it up. June 21st. Currently, we have 4 snow days, and we're in the beginning of February. So welcome, Libby, to the first year of superintendency with the worst winter Central Vermont seen in a while. So that would imply, if we were to follow the contracted allowance, that students would be coming back that Monday right now. As a former second grade teacher, principal, been in education for her entire life, that's a nightmare for teachers, for students, for families, because that's late in the school year. Yeah, it's really late in the school year. Summer camps have started. The buildings are hot. And not much learning takes place. My thought would be to waive that student day, have the staff come back so we can do some really high quality professional learning. And I think we can, because we'll have a very focused idea of what we need to do. And by March, we'll know how many days, hopefully by March, we'll be done. How many days we'll actually have that we could bring some high quality people in, or we could do some high quality professional development with our staff for however many days that is. That would give us leeway, if the board is in agreement to that. We still have 2 more days to play with. Not that it's going to happen. We're going to have just enough snow for skiers and not enough snow for buses to be unhappy. But
2 more days for kids to play.
Yeah, that would reach the 175.
That's required
by
state law.
By state law, yeah. And we'd still have the teachers doing their contracted work days that they'd have. It'd still work out for them. But they'd just be coming back without students. So that's what I would like to do, with your blessings.
I have one question.
Sure.
I've heard a rumor in town that some Montpelier parents have the perception that because we merged with Roxbury, we're having a lot more snow days.
That would not necessarily be true. It may, I mean, to think back to all 4 of them, I couldn't pick exactly who's to blame on that. I do speak to both road crews in the morning, as I've stated before, and there has been one or maybe two that said, Montpelier said they were fine, and Roxbury said, no, we need either more time or we're not gonna get it cleared off. Particularly the ice day is sticking out to me right now. The roads were much worse in Roxbury. They have a smaller road crew. The rain was falling on those, you know, on roads that are different than Montpelier, and the salt just wasn't sticking.
Like yesterday in Montpelier.
Yeah, and probably tonight. So I couldn't answer with any clarity on that, and it's 1 year, you know, and it's it happens to be a bad year. All the superintendents in Central Vermont are struggling with it right now. You know,
I think we've had the same snow days as U32, right?
Yes. We've been
the same as everybody around.
And the same as Twinfield.
And Well, we've had less than Twinfield. We've been the same as U32 and Barry, mm-hmm. and Northfield has one more than us.
Okay.
Those three are really the closest to yeah. us geographically, and so the four of us truly work together. The four superintendents truly work together on our calls, because oftentimes our lines touch. And,
yeah.
you know, John Pandolfo might know something, or Bill Kimball might know something about Berlin and the line between Montpelier and Berlin that I don't know yet.
Right.
So we're in close contact.
And we've had the same as those schools.
Yep. Yep.
Impacted by Roxbury.
Impacted.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean,
really?
It's been a good winter,
happy
but
too.
It's, yeah, it's...
It's been Steve. Extra snowy.
Yeah.
Couple thoughts. One is, if we can do this math one more time. So
sure.
I understand there's 3 days that are that our educators are contractually required to serve, but that the state does not require our students to come for, basically, up to three.
Our teachers are contractually obligated to have 178 teacher-student
yep.
contact days.
Teacher-student contract days, right, okay.
They have more contracted days in
yeah,
their,
sure,
in their
sure,
calendar
sure.
for in-service.
Yeah. Okay, so you're shifting one of the student-teacher, you're suggesting we shift one student-teacher contact day to a non-student-teacher
right.
contract day. Isn't it early to be making a decision like this? And the reason I ask that is
yeah.
because, let's say we have two more,
yes.
we may say, you know what, let's go into that next week,
yeah.
because now we got three.
That's what I was
One makes no sense at all, but two or three might make all the sense in the world. I don't know, I'm not the guy,
yeah.
who, I don't
One
study
of the things,
this stuff.
So Jim and I were talking about this morning as to whether we bring it now, whether we bring it to
yeah.
the next February meeting or even the first March meeting. Some of the things, the principals and I are getting emails asking, because summer camp season is starting.
Oh yeah.
And
vacation season is starting. People
yeah,
are
so people are trying to make plans. And while teachers recognize that those contracted days aren't gonna be waived, kids are a different story.
I see.
So that's one major thing why I think we're talking about it. Another thing, Steve, is that should we go beyond the two more days, right? Should February be awful, but it's not going to be in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Should be awful. We do have one more day that we could play with in the calendar.
Okay.
Where a day, it's the day where it's the half day in service and half day parent conference.
Okay.
We could potentially make that a half day kid day.
Okay.
Student day, and that would buy us back one day.
So now we're safe, basically.
Yeah.
From whatever might happen.
Yeah. So there's some other gears turning,
okay.
just in case if March is miserable.
Then it does make sense to get out early on it. I was thinking we may be forced to go over anyway or something. And
that gives us
a lot of cushion.
Yeah, that gives us more reason to play,
yeah.
more wiggle room.
The other thing, and it's not really for tonight, but is to in the spirit of what Michelle asked about, you know, clarifying how decisions are made or not made, is to be really clear with families about how a snow day is called. Kind of what is that? Kind of a morning in the life of a superintendent on a snow day, where, you know, what are the calls you make? How are these things made? Because the grumbling, when we put together the merger, it was one of the reassurances we received, which is that, oh no, that won't happen, right? And in fact,
because the factors that go into that are so complex,
yeah.
we have all the teachers who are commuting here from Chittenden
right.
County.
Well, so Libby did this already for us.
And so,
yeah,
she did this for us.
She did.
She provided this in a report to us.
Oh, it was this
yeah.
time.
Which was
No.
Okay, I missed that. Okay.
January.
But
so,
you could
maybe
use
out to
the bridge for an
yeah,
example. This might be a good opportunity to do some outreach to the community.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
so to
you did
to
this to us.
Corner of the bridge. That's a good
idea.
Great.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
a communication opportunity for diffusing some of the stress about this, and also talking about how, you know, we know that families are planning. We know this is important to get out early on these things. So we're really trying to lock down that last day of school as best as we possibly can.
Yeah. I think letting more people know about this, and you essentially already have it put together. So just
to make you feel better, even though they had a 3 day or because of a physical issue, Cambridge is working on 8 days.
Well, there are some superintendents in my Winooski crew who, I mean, literally, they're crying when we're all on the email together in the morning saying, no.
Thanks.
Nobody likes to call a snow day or delay. Jim and I were saying that we thought it was important for the board to start gears turning around what potential we could do to make this easier for families, and the sooner they know, the better off they'll be for the last student day.
And do we need to take action today? Should we?
Can we?
Can we?
If we wait, what is the advantage of doing it now versus after town meeting day?
Families would know sooner.
Families right now, we're calling principals, et cetera, saying, you know, we want to go to wherever the week of the 24th, or we want to send my kids to a two-week go-away camp that starts the 23rd. Are they going to be in school that week or not?
Yeah.
There's an answer.
Because lacking action, short of action, we're now rolling it into the next week.
Yes.
Like, if we don't take an action,
the
de facto default is it is in the next week. Okay.
June 24th, which is the last week of June.
Because believe it or not, Andrew, parents are now signing up their kids for their summer activities.
I believe it.
I'm already locked out of three of them.
I was talking to a parent in Roxbury who runs a summer camp, and she said, my first week of summer camp is the 24th, Libby. Like, what? Do I cancel it? What do I do?
On the other hand, even if we take this action, back to Steve, you can't predict how much snow will be in February.
No.
So
or March.
Or March.
Or March.
Or March.
That's true.
Or April.
Yes.
Right.
That was on April 30th last year.
Stop it.
Yeah.
That's true.
A lot.
Yeah.
Jim was on the slopes.
Right. So what would we, do we need a vote on this?
Sounds like we should.
It's a contract issue.
This would be a board's decision.
Yeah.
So, I took the vote. It would still be somewhat tentative because if there were.
Well, not tentative as of today.
So
but
we could
change.
We could override ourselves.
So it would be a narrow motion, right? The motion would be to move to waive one of the student teacher contact days in the contract, basically.
Well, shouldn't we waive up to three of them, depending?
Just in case.
Really?
To give, I would say, because then just to give her authority.
Up to three at the superintendent's discretion.
Yeah, at the superintendent's discretion.
Oh, okay.
That's what I mean.
For
a very narrow reason.
So it doesn't change. We need to have without.
We need
175. We need 175 for the kids.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
So
we have to go to the state if we wanted to waive.
Right. That's what I'm saying. She can't waive the kids, so the kids will always get 175.
But to waive one day at the superintendent, up to 3 days at the superintendent's discretion for the purpose of maintaining June 21st as the last. Student day of school.
Yeah.
That's kind of the decision making.
Cool.
So not for other reasons.
Yes.
Do you want to say that as a motion?
Sure. I move that we waive one contractual, one day.
Three.
Up to three.
Up to 3 days in the contract for teacher-student contact. At the discretion of the superintendent for the purpose of maintaining June 21st as the last day of school for students. Is it only that one contract? It's all contracts? No, it's just one, right?
No, we do.
I believe it's just the one, it's a BMEA contract.
Okay.
That talks of student days.
Okay.
And you should the motion continue and use those days for teacher, for professional development?
Yeah, but not to waive them as required days, effectively. So, only to waive
the student.
I don't know how the contract's written, so I don't know. But yeah, sure. What Bridget said.
The number of days, I'm pretty sure it is.
I just want to make sure we don't vote.
Question.
They're not just gone.
If it's, if it's spelled out in the contract, is it? I'd have to look. We have our contract. Is it spelled out in the contract though, specifically for teacher-student days? Because if we're waiving that. And then we're saying, but teachers, you're still going to work, but not within the parameter that the contract states. I don't know about that.
That's a good point.
I don't know that we can require teachers to do that if it's spelled out that clearly in the contract.
The number of days that teachers work is required.
The number of days that teachers work is required.
And the number of days of student
contact
are.
And that's
are
two
required.
Different numbers.
Yes.
And
yes.
This would be
so this
a non-negotiated thing.
Okay.
And Andrew, this is a common occurrence.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, it's right. Not something unique that I'm asking for. And there's nothing.
Each contract's different, though, as we've been
learning.
So I just want to make sure that, you know, where it stipulates.
There's nothing in the contract about a date certain for teachers, is that correct?
No. A date of end. No, there's not.
Is it 16 in the teacher role?
Searchable.
I think I know that. The work year will be 188 days, structured in the following manner. Gentlemen, I'm on page 18.
Thank you.
188 days.
Yeah.
So they have 10 contracted days without students.
Yeah. 178 student days. So if those aren't student days. Yeah, but to take those days and make them not student days and say that they're going to be used for other things,
I can check with the union.
Yeah.
See,
can we do that?
I can. I've had some conversations with them already about this.
Okay.
But I can make sure.
Could we do that first before we vote on this, since we're in the process of negotiating?
What if we just add a clause to this that it's in consultation
with the
union?
Yeah, that sounds great.
So that it, you know, right.
Yeah.
That for if you run into any problem, you just back off and we regroup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. And thinking big picture, so there would be no student who would essentially fail a grade because their parents kept them home on June 22nd rather than sending them to school for the very last day that it's required. It would be June 24th, would be the Monday, but when is that?
There is very little learning happening on
right.
the last day of school.
I mean, right, like it's just like
it's a random Monday.
Yeah.
Monday to June.
That's the whole
point.
It's
not
going
to be, right.
I'm pretty sure we did this
I think
last
somebody
year
told me that you
because
had
the because they were gonna have to come back on Monday and
which
I believe
right.
somebody happens. From the union has says that you've done that before.
Yeah, I think we did it last year.
Okay.
Okay. I second Steve's motion.
All any discussion? Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. We have our snow day situation cleared
Thank
up.
You for that.
You're welcome. Let's quickly do principal search. We have a big committee that is growing. As such, we would like the board seek to run. So what I propose is that we appoint someone and then we appoint an alternate who may come on if either some of the seats don't materialize or the first person search is unable to do it for scheduling and other reasons. Michelle has...
Pick me.
Yes. there's a couple of people who are interested, Michelle and Tina. I suggest we appoint Michelle with Tina as the alternate. Michelle has two high school students.
I do.
And knows all things high school. I think it would be excellent, as would Tina. Tina has done many, many principal search. She doesn't have not current ones.
Thank you both.
Or future ones.
I'm sensing something from you.
Were either of you two on the committee that hired Mike, just out of curiosity?
I was, as well as Carol Puckett.
Well, you did a great job with that hire.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Most definitely.
So that's what I propose. Do we need a motion for that, or do we just appoint?
I don't think we need a motion.
Yeah, sounds great. Thank you both.
And we're just in the process of getting that posting up.
Yes, the posting should be up tomorrow.
Yeah.
I was got an email in our inbox saying post it.
So we do have some time to do some broader outreach to try to attract.
And a plan.
And a plan, and yeah, exactly, to attract a more diverse pool and hopefully get some, not just more diverse folks, but also some folks from out of state who might be interested. Like last year, we were in crunch mode, and I don't think have the ability to outreach and go through different channels like we do this year. But there's a plan to do that. So
great. We did have mostly out of state applicants last time. for the principal.
You did.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
What has turnover been like? We've had two principals in the past 4 years or something like that?
No, we had Adam Bunting for maybe 3 or 4 years, and then we had Mike for 4 years.
Oh, Mike's been here for 4 years.
Yeah, this is his fourth year.
Time flies.
And that this, I have a daughter who's a senior, and the seniors are very attached to him because he arrived at the same time that they did, and now he's leaving at the same time. They're very emotional about it.
Remember how emotional they were about Adam Bunting.
And they forgot that like 10 seconds later.
No, well, in fact, part of
that's when you get a really, Mike's been just amazing.
Very, yeah, yeah, all summer people were like, well, he's not going to be any Adam Bunting,
right.
That's for sure.
Right.
And then.
No, he wasn't. He's not.
He's not.
No, he's so different.
But he's
so
Mike
good.
Great.
He was principal here and then went back to.
Great. Thanks. We can.
He looks up there too.
Interglad.
Yeah.
Unless there's any more comments about principals. Thank you, Michelle, and Tina, for setting up.
So I apologize. Heather handed out the questions and answers after. In fact, she handed them out this morning, so they weren't part of the original board packet, and that was my mistake. I simply forgot to forward them to her. So, just trying to get to that document. Sorry.
They're not in the packet.
They were sitting,
oh, they were.
They were sitting on our table.
Oh,
table.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yes.
Thank you. Okay. So I can just go through here the questions that I received, and feel free to ask any additional questions. If I don't have the answer tonight, then I will most definitely write it down and get you the answers you need. Under goal one and opportunity two, it was the long-term planning from the board's perspective, would assist leadership in moving us forward. And the question was, are you guys working on that? Working on a plan to make that happen. So I don't want to speak for Jim, but he certainly can speak well enough for himself. But we're in the beginning stages of focusing this work. We've had some very beginning conversations just recently about number one, increasing the equity in regards to the achievement gap that we have for all our students. Two, building district capacity in the racial, gender, and ability equity, so a kind of different lens through that work. Three, visioning for the future of RVS in particular. And four, facilities, and making sure all our facilities are up to date and the quality that we want for our learning environments for students. Those were our initial conversations, and when I say initial, I mean very initial conversations to answer that question. Do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I suppose to it. I mean, we're getting, we might want to add health to that as well, because we're getting questions about both how we teach sex and sexuality. We're also getting questions about drug use, marijuana use, vaping, et cetera. So.
Did you see the legislation report that they do have something up for to extend that vaping, the electronic e-cigarette or whatever? Extend the age?
But that will be a conversation of this spring, and I think this summer we want to really kind of delve into that. And one thing we've talked about, particularly on equity and the achievement gap, has been a subject that we've been talking about for a long time. I think it would be great to really put a plan in place to articulate how we're going to do that, both from a systems perspective and from an investment perspective. And use that as kind of a driving force in the conversation we're going to the community next year around the budget and kind of going forward. That, we talk a lot about this, but here's how we're really going to do it.
And the leadership team is hard at work at that right now. We will be bringing something to the board to share soon around that and throughout the spring.
That's a really great way to put it, I think, because I think we've talked about it for so long now, and the kind of the drop approach, like we're gonna add this little position here, 3/4 of a position over here, we've changed a curriculum approach over here, but it feels almost as if there's not a coordination of, like best practice has been looked at, we got an idea, we've done some research, we've got some data, and now here is the strategic plan on addressing equity, and it includes a lot of stuff, and you're not gonna get it all in the first year, but it's a big plan, and it's more of a package than it is just a drop here and a drop there, and that would really, I think, help our community understand the serious commitment.
We got it going on.
That's exactly the kind of approach we need to do.
We've spent probably the last, so I meet with the leadership team weekly, and I'd say the last 2.5 months, every meeting, we've been working on developing our scales and what we're thinking about.
That's great. And then the health thing is great, and I was noticing tying it into the gender piece too. I think if we can, health, education, and gender equality
huge.
Going together, kind of understanding those as a unit, and that it needs to be, you know, very specifically reflected in our health education curriculum is gender equity.
Huge.
Yeah.
So under goal 3, my narrative stated that we have extremely challenging needs that our schools currently do not have the capacity to handle. The question was asked, what needs are we talking about? Why don't we have the capacity? What do we need in order to handle this? Are we outsourced or what? I'm not gonna read that entire paragraph to you, but just kind of highlight the ideas that we're truly working with right now. We have actually less than most school districts in terms of extremely challenging kids who exhibit extremely challenging behaviors for multiple reasons. And we
have less of those children.
I think we have less than those children than I've seen in other districts. And that could be for multiple reasons as well. However, that's not going away, and it's not going to get smaller. So currently, another thing the leadership team is working on, particularly the assistant principals, because they're often the driving force behind this work, is how do we work and support and provide high quality environments for kids who might need something different from our schools at this moment in their lives, not all the time, but in this moment of their lives. How do we build the capacity of our staff so that they can build relationships with kids who are sometimes hard to build relationships with. And that's, all of these things are hard to talk about, but they're a reality. How do we build plans for kids and stick to it? Because we often know that kids who are really challenged, Tina's like, yeah, I got it. Kids who are really challenged, and you put a plan in place, will buck it really hard at first before it starts working. And oftentimes school systems give up. And so how do we do that? That's a big challenge for, should our budget be passed the social emotional coordinator to support those plans and support the team and be the person behind it saying, yep, this is gonna work, just give it more time, we're collecting, you know, that person. So we're putting very basic building blocks in place around this right now. The regional superintendents we're all talking about this. A couple superintendents have gone so far as to create budgetary outlines as to how much time, energy, and money is actually being spent on what percentage of kids who are experiencing this right now. I have not done that. I don't necessarily think it's a great exercise, but that's how far people are going to show how much money and time school districts are spending towards this population. And many of us are concerned with the capacity of Washington County Mental Health, who are people we rely on for support in this area, and their capacity to support us, because they're overmatched right now. And when we need more help in regards to an outside placement or a temporary outside placement or somebody to come in to help us, they simply don't have the staff or the space for that at the moment. And so then we're with a child who needs something more than we can give them, and it's not fair to the child, it's not fair to the family, and it's not fair to us. It's not fair to our educators who are stressed and want to do their best, and they just don't know how. So like I said, this isn't a huge number of kids right now, but it's enough and it's serious enough, and if we care about all kids and we want to do the best for all kids, that we need to put some more thought and effort and plans in place for this. Go ahead, Michelle.
So we had a lengthy and detailed presentation maybe 3 years ago on shifting our special education delivery model, because we had been outplacing those kids.
And that.
And we changed, and that was extremely costly.
Mm-hmm.
And the theory was that if we stopped without, if we resorted to outplacement less often and instead created more effective structures within particularly the elementary school to be able to adapt to the needs of those kids, that it would be better for everyone because those kids would be more a part of our community, our teachers
yep.
would develop more in terms of their capacity to work
yep.
with those, that population, and we would save, and did save, a tremendous amount of money on outplacement. But do you think that that model is the right way to go?
Or? I agree with that model for 99% of our students. I think there is still 1% that's going to need a different placement than what we can provide. And I think that's just the reality. I think it's small percentage.
Right. I guess my question is, do you think that it would be more, do you think it would be better to put a couple more kids in outplacement, or do you think it would be better to increase our ability to meet their needs within the building?
Yes. I would answer that yes.
Both of those
yeah.
things.
Yeah. I wonder, so we say build the capacity of teachers a lot. You see, hear that
yeah.
out of my mouth a lot. You hear that, I'm sure you've heard about from other leaders a lot.
But they're only so big, the teachers.
I know. That's true.
Capacity.
And so much they can handle,
right?
So what supports, so my question would be, in that time frame, which we're still working on, right? How much professional support have teachers gotten? How much structural support in regards to human resources have we put in place? You all have made, whoever was on the board at the time when we put social workers in each of our schools
mm-hmm.
as employees of ours and not contracted out,
mm-hmm.
I applaud you for that decision, because not everybody has made that decision. And at the same time, how are we supporting that social worker? Because since they're part of our school employee, they now don't have the expertise and consultation from another outside entity.
Yeah.
They only rely on each other. So I met with a social worker. This is really fresh because I just met with the social workers. And they quite rightly said, we need contact with other people to get expertise that, you know, we're going by our gut, basically. And we want them to go by what best practice is. Not to say they're not, you know,
right.
But I want their gut to be really fueled by what's best practice.
I think at least two of them are quite new, aren't
yep.
they? Quite young.
Yep.
I mean, so.
Yep. But they came from the world. You know, they came from the world of mental health consultation.
Right.
So
but
they've had that
they
experience.
They could probably use continuing.
Yes. Exactly. And so, what's our plan for those three, in particular? What's their job description to make sure that we're really clear that they're targeting the families and the kiddos that need them the most? We haven't done that work yet, and we need to.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping the new person that we hire will be in tight communication with our curriculum coordinator, because...
Funny you say that. Part of the job description is that that person will report to Director of Curriculum and Director of Student Services.
Yes. Because not the 1%, but the 1.5,
yep.
Instruction is the key to keeping them into that classroom.
Absolutely. And Mike and Mary are well aware of what it will be, that will be a joint endeavor and there will be no silos.
Well, and we've been talking for now a couple of years about first tier, you know, making sure
yep.
our first tier is universal design, so that we're really doing as much as we can to shift that, I guess, to shift everything down a little bit.
To support kids when they need it, so,
yeah.
so that we
right.
can
and take
not
the pressure
the
off the more intensive
yeah.
Intervention.
Mm-hmm.
So, Libby, an hour ago, when Secretary French was talking about Act 173 and the shift in implementation for special ed,
mm-hmm.
what were you thinking in terms of the regional work you guys are doing now to implement this kind of work? Like, how those two things are going to come together? Is Act 173 going to help?
Yes.
Or is it so?
It's going to help us.
Because
we're on top of it.
Okay.
She says confidently. I don't want you all to hear that's a special education law. That's a good quality instruction law for all kids and getting support to kids who need it when they need it.
Sure.
Currently, the current funding system doesn't allow us to do that. to the best of our ability. And so if Jim's a special educator and Bridget is a general, it creates these silos that Jim's kids, Bridget's kids, you know, like things, separate. Stuff that does not help us.
So 173 creates those silos or breaks them
down? No, is attempting to break those
okay.
down so that we could use the resources that Jim could provide to kids who may not be on an IEP, not ignoring any kid who's on an IEP and needs it, but could also bring more kids into the service plan.
So they don't end up on an IEP.
Exactly. That's why I keep talking about monthly tiered systems of support, because really that's what that law is about, is enabling us to have the funding and the human resource we need to make a high quality multi-tiered system of support model go.
For everybody.
So that's where we're starting with our work, and when we come with our plan, as our package, as Steve just said so eloquently, that's what you're gonna see a whole lot of in that plan. It's okay. A very little talk of special education, but a lot of talk of what are we doing as educators to service all of our students in a way that best supports them.
Okay.
What would be a theoretical example of how a student who might not be helped now would be helped?
So currently, if a student, a lot of times I'll stick to academics because that's really where I have more knowledge base around this, right? So let's pick a second grader who's having a hard time really understanding the concept of subtraction. A lot of times that kiddo just needs more time. They need more time, they might need it explained in a different way, they might need more manipulatives in front of them. Currently, the classroom teacher is responsible, right, for that learning. If the kiddo is on an IEP, then the special educator could help a kid. If they're not, the special educator can only help that kid if they have a group that is has the right ratio of kids with an IEP who also need the same services and others,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's not like a given, because we have to do these silly time schedules that really, with special education, because of the funding, right? 173 gets rid of that idea. So if a special educator, so what we can do is we can make learning specialists with our extra human resource or in regards to special education, in regards to intervention services, truly make them experts in how do I teach math, right? And how do I teach reading and how do I teach writing, so that we have experts who say, oh, this is the profile of a kid who needs this. I know how to attack that. So let's get the service they need. It doesn't matter if they have an IEP or not in place. So it opens up the door for us to do that. However, what I keep saying is I don't want to put more people into a broken system. Right, because I don't want it to be Andrew's got trouble in math, which we all know he doesn't based on his negotiation skills, but Andrew's got trouble in math, and so Tina's his teacher and says, I taught it, he didn't learn it, I got all these people to come take him out of my classroom and he's not my problem anymore, right? And our teachers aren't as blatant as that, you know, but I have seen that, right? So we want to ensure that we have clearly delineated our tiers of support for kids and when they access them and for what. Before we really start digging into these are the amount of human resources we need. Make sense?
Yes.
Yeah.
There's also the issue of you spoke about more time. I might need more time, and you as the teacher and the rest of the class is ready to proceed on. But wait, I need more time.
But those two kids
in
the entire third grade need more
time.
Yeah, exactly.
And I will catch up, but only if I have a little help to catch up.
And that little extra help can't be neglecting what the prioritized standards in the classroom is moving towards, right? It has to be in addition to. So we have some scheduling to work out. So does that help with that one?
Yes.
So goal three, clarify district values and ensure our system and practices match those values. The question asked was, this looks like board work, so again, a plan to make that happen. And I think that's directly related to the first question. I think as a board, we have a lot of talking to do and a lot of planning to do, particularly in the late summer or late spring and summer. And I look forward to working with you all on that kind of stuff.
With regard to Act 173, do you think at some point, it sounds like we're going to be receiving all sorts of information related to 173, but do you think at some point it would make sense to provide us an overview, because sometimes you provide us updates with regard to curriculum design and policy implementation, like how we're leveraging Act 173.
I can certainly do that. I'm going to give it more a little more time.
Yeah.
Right now, we've gotten Mary on all kinds of legislative committees.
Sure.
So we got an inside track.
Yeah.
To it. She said, Libby, do you mind if I volunteer on that? I'm like, go be that person.
Yeah.
So she's got a voice at the table, and she's a person who truly understands breaking down silos and helping all kids. So I think she's going to be a good person for us to be there. Right now, when Dan says we're working out the rules, they're working out the rules.
Right.
And that's where they are right now.
Right.
We have 2 years. But I think we're ahead of the gang in terms of our planning right now, because others are thinking about just the money, and we're thinking about service delivery and systems.
Awesome.
So I think we're in a good spot.
That's great.
In regards to this. But once those kind of things start to get more ironed out at the legislature and the state board, then we can have Mary come in and really explain it.
Awesome.
And that's it, unless you all looked at that document again and have more questions from me. And by all means, you can always send them to me, too.
Any other questions? Otherwise, we can move on to the policy group. Thank you, Libby. So up next, policies, I think, our second policy reading of the equity policy. We got the one that Heather passed out is this
is the most up to date
one in our packet.
This has, right? It should say October 2019 on the top.
October?
With the cross dots.
Well, October cross dots. Yes, excuse me. Okay.
Great.
Lots
thank
of red there.
So this is the second policy reading. So the changes Marta. I read the one I got in our packet, and it looks accurate to me in terms of what we talked about, but unless we also have an alternative to work out.
I think the one in the packet was the same as the one that
was
we looked at before.
The old one.
And that's why Brian and I circulated.
Oh, okay.
So
this
great
one.
That looks good. Yeah. Yeah.
The one that came by email from Ryan and then got handed out today has a little bit more language that we tried to track what we talked about at the meeting.
Correct. Good.
And that's shown in underlined red.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm seeing the changes now.
So you can see the addition of family composition in the third paragraph.
The recruitment language.
Yeah, the recruitment language, which is now really just a delegation to the superintendent. That was a change.
Conflict resolution.
I don't love the 5 to 6 line long sentences. It's just a stylistic thing, but we try to cram I think they're verging on run on sentences, and we're cramming in a lot of huge ideas in one sentence. This is just a stylistic thing. I think under 3 expectations for recruitment practices and professional development, expectations for curriculum, we could do a better job of just breaking those into 2 sentences and more clearly spelling out the subject and the objects, so that you're not wait, what is this in reference to again? As you're going through it. That's just a stylistic thing. I don't know if anybody else shares that. I'm not going to the mat over it. It's just something I'm wondering.
Are you talking about just under 3?
He was talking about number 4.
And number 3, professional
and number
development.
3, professional development. Yeah, I was wondering if it made sense maybe to use semicolons? Because it's more of a list.
That is quite a sentence.
It's really a list, and I think both of those, it's kind
it's
of a
just,
list.
It's just you, by the time you get to the end, you're like, wait, what?
Track.
What is, the function of this right now? A little reminder by splitting it up and just inserting the subject in there again might be helpful, but just throwing that out.
You can play around with some wordsmithing.
But I think the policy is great, and I don't want to, there's very little that I like content wise. I think this is really a terrific document. I just want to throw that out there. Not to be negative or anything.
It's that vision to get so much in there.
Yeah, I mean I think
it's actually not that easy to break up that sentence, although it clearly needs to be broken up.
Yeah.
I wonder if it's a bullet instead of a sentence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
More of a listing.
Yeah, that might be, there you are, that might be a really good way of dealing with it.
Yeah.
I actually think that could be really helpful.
So maybe the bullets could be, strengthen the knowledge and skills needed to identify and counteract their own biases could be one bullet.
Mm-hmm.
Counteract bias practices that perpetuate achievement disparities and contribute to disproportionate access and outcome can be a bullet, and strengthen the inclusiveness of classroom environment.
Yeah, I think that'd be perfect. Yeah. That would be super clear. I think that's a great way of addressing it. Yeah.
Okay.
And I think we could do something kind of similar for the next one, expectations for curriculum.
So colon, and then ensure all students, blah, blah, blah. Except that's kind of one concept that's really long.
Yeah, that's
concepts are very long.
Yes.
I mean, where it says and that the curriculum
mm-hmm.
incorporates, I feel like we could put a period there and then district will continually evaluate its curriculum and other.
Add a verb.
Curriculum.
Something like the district will ensure the curriculum incorporates the boys culture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In
just,
addition,
yeah.
they will.
Just to break it up, so
yeah.
my concern is that these are all really
right.
important points, and when they're all put together like that, they kind of like blend together. Yeah. I think the content is really, really good.
On number 5,
yes.
I prefer the alternative because it does include a section that says we'll particularly address impacts on students from marginalized communities. The other paragraph above it doesn't have that anymore.
I agree with Lisa that the alternative is better, largely because at first I liked the upper one better because it was simpler, but it says the consequences for students who engage in that conduct. But what conduct? There's no reference above that
mm-hmm.
to any sort of conduct.
Mm.
And I know we were trying to avoid talking about hazing, harassment, and bullying because it's so uber defined, but if you start trying to define conduct for which there are consequences and of which people are targets, I think you wind up back at the defined conducts. I don't think there's any in between redefining.
We honestly remembered the discussions lately differently, and I couldn't, whether we were trying to not talk about hazing harassment
right.
or we just wanted to separate them out into two different sentences. So that's why it's in two different ways.
Yep.
And those are three words. People spend a lot of time on legally to
mm-hmm.
differentiate between what those three things are. So it's, to me, it's worth having because the definitions are legally established.
Yeah. And I don't think the alternative blends the concepts. And I think it's clear that there are different concepts going on. But,
that's a good point that conduct is not defined.
And to try to define it.
Well, right, because, I mean, there's some conduct that we're talking about for which there may not be consequences, actually,
right.
but it's still
yeah.
conduct we want to educate
yeah.
about.
Hmm.
I appreciate your work going from nothing to this. Great job.
A lot of people involved.
Yeah, it's a big team.
Very good. Okay. So then just to be clear, we're happy with the alternative as it's presented?
Is the alternative.
Great.
Okay.
That's simple.
Okay. Any other comments on the edits?
Is it ready to go on the consent agenda next time? Or do folks want to? There's three choices. It could come back for discussion. could come back for discussion and adoption, not on the consent agenda, if it was more, or it could come back for adoption on the consent agenda. I think those are the options.
Well, it could come back, let me try this. It could come back on the consent agenda with the corrections we have. And if anyone objected to them, they could pull it off the mm-hmm. consent agenda.
Okay, correct.
That.
I just didn't know if people felt they were at that point.
One thing.
Well, Emma and Hope said that they had seen the changes on the Google Drive. Have they been coming to the committee meetings? Do they have an opportunity to read?
We had sent, they were included after the first round.
You know what, if you could make the changes, let's plan on putting it on the consent agenda. If you could make the changes soon, then I can get it to the RJA and tell them that they have a quick turnaround time, and if they make significant changes, then when we make the agenda, we just won't put it on there. Does that work?
Sure.
We won't put it on as consent, we'll put it on as an agenda item.
The question I have is, you know, I think that this is a big deal. I think this is a great thing. Whether it's on the consent agenda or not, I think it's worth acknowledging when we adopt it. And I would love to hear from Emma and Hope when we adopt this, you know, their thoughts
yes.
on it.
Just make an agenda item. It's a quick
that's
one.
That's what I was thinking is
yeah.
maybe
yeah.
we don't have to spend much time, but kind of memorialize
yeah.
it
yeah.
Right. rather than just gloss over it.
We want to wait until March 6th.
The slight challenge is that our next board meeting is in Roxbury. Not that that's in and of itself a challenge, but thus far Hope and Emma haven't won. I've offered transportation out there and everything, but for their own reasons, they haven't chosen to come to those board meetings in Roxbury. So we can have Adam speak for the entire student body.
It wasn't in Roxbury.
Oh, wait.
What?
You weren't in
But
Roxbury.
He doesn't go to Roxbury either.
Yeah. Yeah, he does.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Well,
yeah.
Yeah.
He passed in.
Sometimes
he
I didn't.
Yeah. There used to be, someone else used to come to the Roxbury one.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Matt might take my place one day. Yes.
Came.
I can talk to him about it, though.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe since they asked us, it would be nice for them. If it was to happen at the first March,
yeah, that's what
yeah.
I was thinking.
They could comment how they're feeling now that the policy is written.
Yeah, that's what I was kind of hoping, something
yeah.
along those lines. I thought that would be.
So Tina, if you adopted at the next meeting, then have them make sure that they're free to comment at the March 6th meeting.
We could do that. I was thinking about holding it.
Oh, just holding it. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Heather's
like
got an idea.
Need to have it.
Yeah.
Let's move to March 6th.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
there's amazing voice.
Thank you.
Meeting's gonna look quick.
I think they're probably already frustrated with how slow we move.
They just want me to get to the procedures. They
they're done. We were clear about the process.
So we have a quick executive session. I think we're gonna stay in this room. Libby wants to go to
Charlie. My phone is lighting up.
Oh,
yeah.
That's how bad 89 is.
Yeah, the conditions are not good.
I'm surprised you're here at all, honestly.
Yeah. So, dedicated too.
Yeah, we'll drive safely.